Okay, let's have a look at swales. Swales are long level excavations that come in many forms and widths. They can be just small ridges in gardens, or rock piles across a slope, or excavated hollows in flatlands and low slope landscapes. They're not elements that fit into steep landscape. Like soil conditioning, swales loosen soils and absorb water, storing it in the soils and the sediments. They intercept sheet flow and let it infiltrate, recharging the groundwater. Overland flow is interrupted for a few hours or a few days, and then infiltration becomes regularly downwards. Water moving at right angle to conduit down towards the groundwaters as a recharge into the soils and assisted by the tree roots. Trees are essential as components of swale systems. So most of the time, our swales on slope, they're a mound excavated out from the trench to the mound, and our topsoil is increased at the mound and it's loose. And most of the time we're planting trees up on the mound here and just below. In deserts we may plant inside because we've got less rainfall and it's hard to drown the trees in the desert. So you may move inside, but the infiltration of water is at right angle to contour and it plumes away as it sits here and then soaks in. We also plant the backslope, often leguminous trees on the backslope here, fixing nitrogen. And the roots here help the absorption. So the roots grow quickly, chasing the water as it goes down, slowly soaking in. Swales without trees risk waterlogging and local rainfall deficit because of the lack of evapotranspiration and the potential of too much water storage. Because they're on contour, interrupting the sheet flow, they stop all the water moving past just temporarily and then just soak it in. That water disappears into the soil. The trees take some of that back and transpire it to the atmosphere. Tree planting must accompany swales in all areas. So swales, I like to say, are tree growing systems. And it's of utmost importance in deserts where there's so much rain that's needed. So there's a chance that as you interrupt the flows of rain that comes so infrequently and often in large events, you can stop it, soak it, grow trees that transpire more water to the cloud base. There's a chance it's going to increase the rainfall. It will definitely increase the condensation in deserts. The potential crown spread of the fringing trees. So as the trees grow, the crown spread from one side to the other, shading the swale. This is what we need to understand. The width of the swale can be governed by the crown spread that will shade our swale, further reducing water loss to evaporation and dissolving salt concentration and water loss, because this water won't evaporate, it'll soak. Now, the backslopes and the inside trenches of swales can be grazed. It's possible to run animals in here and put temporary fences up and graze animals on the backslope up to the inside of the mound. Eventually, it won't make any difference, but grassing a swale won't have the same effect as the trees. Grazing between the backslope and the hangover forage from the swale trees can be quite beneficial because the manuring here in the swale, when it rains, dilutes right the way along the swale. You get an even dilution of manure all the way along, and that's soaking in. But you can't expect grasses and herbaceous growth to have anywhere near the same evapotranspiration to the cloud base. You've got to have the trees with their deep tap roots to increase that absorption. Swales can be widely used across the climates. Dry land areas, they can be very large because you've got to stop as much rain as you can when it comes in those large events and soak it in and get through most of the year. Reassuring your landscape of trees, tree growth giving you shade, tree growth stopping evaporation from wind. They also, of course, work in humid tropics and humid, cool to cold climates. And the hydration of the swell builds over about 7 years. Each year, year one, year two, year three, year four, it gets up to about year seven and you've got the maximum rehydration plume, where each time it rains, it comes a bit more and then you get to a maximum. And it will fully hydrate to the maximum size and then quickly drop off the bottom. They'll be recharged, the maximum recharge to the groundwater. So you have a dampened hydrology that wets up as quickly as possible. Water available from wet season to dry season. It doesn't matter that it rains in winter and your growing season is in summer, because it extends over one season. And the roots reach their maximum influence at about 7 years. So the roots of the trees are coming down and they're increasing the infiltration effect. Essentially, swales are always perfectly dead level with no water flow. So water sits passively, rises like a tide, and then soaks in. They're not compacted and they're not sealed. They're made to soak. They're uncompacted. Swale width and swale depth can vary in relation to the size of a property. Small properties, small swales, of course. Large properties can be quite large. Slope can make a difference. The speed of infiltration on local soil types. Shallower, wider swales in sands and narrower, deeper swales often in clay fraction soils. And after one or two good soaking rains, you can seed and plant your swale to trees. On both banks, because you've got a certain amount of soak on both sides, capillary action will take the water out to the backslope and on down. And it will take a few years to overshade the swale base and accumulate humus from leaf drop. There will be a certain amount of leaves coming in and accumulation of humus, but there will be, after a few years, a lot of leaf drop from the actual trees. And as efficiency increases, extra water can be let in. So you can lead in diversion drains from country, picking up water from hard surfaces, overland flow, extra water, enabling planting of high-value trees. So you can bring in different trees as the swale starts to function better and better. You can increase the quality of trees. And the swale itself can handle more and more water over time. So that enables you to move the system up, advance it in quality. And that's what they're all about, advancing the quality of the system. Swales can be a great benefit with hard surface runoff in towns, particularly subhumid and arid towns. It can reduce the costs of the efficiency of stormwater runoff, soaking the water into tree growth. Tree growth that could produce fuel, mulch, food products, even fireproof towns. All roof water and roof water tank overflows, grey water waste could be led to swales. And it doesn't really matter if swales are in sand or in clay, in sand or even cinder ash. They grow trees, initially pioneer trees, that slow and absorb and hold water for longer. And once established, high-value trees can then be planted. And swales at the opposite end of the scale in heavy clays work well. Initially growing pioneer trees with roots that penetrate the clay, breaking it up and increasing the absorption. So it's not the material that you're swaling through, it's the pioneer trees that you might have to go to in sand as you're planning initially, or in clay. The different types of pioneer trees that actually favor the different extremes of material. And then as the conditions change, as you improve the absorption, as you improve the fertility, then you move into high quality trees. We know that this works. The trees grow faster and are healthier on runoff fed swales than trees planted in open country. In arid areas, it's most important we plant trees on swales, or salt concentration may occur downhill and collapse soils. So we know the trees are pumping the water cycle and stopping the concentrations of salts. Swales are just temporary events, really, over the long period of time. They're replaced by trees. Trees take over the function. They are the precursors to the rehabilitation of forests in a region. And they give us that convenient contour lineage to work with. The base of a swale, when we look at the base of a swale, it can be ripped to increase absorption. It could be graveled, so we can gravel the base of a swale. Or it could be sanded. And on small swales, they can even be mulched. So you can deep mulch a swale in a small swale in a garden. You won't have enough material for a large swale. Or you can put down gypsum to loosen clay if you're in heavy clay soils to allow more water infiltration. The spoil of the swale is normally mounded downhill. So our topsoil's there, the excavation has come over to our mound. But in flat country, there might not be a mound, because in flat country, we'll spread the material out on the lower side usually, but it won't look like there's a mound at all. So you'll get a flat profile of a swale. And the distance between swales changes to country. On hill country, the potential vertical height of the trees at maturity projected horizontally to the hill as a maximum density. That's an average sort of approach. So as a hill comes down and it changes in steepness, where we have our swales, the height of the trees projected back, the potential height of the trees comes back each time. And that's the maximum amount of swales we need. So as we go into the steeper country, that projected height makes the swales closer together. As we get on the steep, it's closer. As we get on the shallow, it's further apart. But when we look down from the bottom of the hill, when we look up, all we can see is canopy. It looks like the whole landscape is forested, but there's lots of interswale there, because these are actual lines of trees. There's a group of trees in that line. But that's just a rough gauge. There's no exact about this. It can change to country. Another way to gauge distance is 3 to 20 times the average swale width, depending on rainfall. Most useful average size swale bases are around 1 to 2 meters, and the interswale space 3 to 18 meters, but there's no absolute average. It's more likely that the closer spacing in rainfall that's quite large, say 120 centimeters, 50 inches, and wider spacing in rainfall of light small rains of 10 inches, 25 centimeters or less. In humid areas, the interswale is usually fully planted with hardy species, and many of them as mulch-producing species. In dry areas, maybe it's quite bare and mainly functioning as runoff for the swales themselves. But mulch will blow into swales and wash into swales.
As water flows, it'll bring organic matter in. Organic matter will arrive in swales
and fine dusts and silts build up in the swale bases. They become deposition systems. They're collecting all kinds of detritus material. That in itself is increasing fertility.
They naturally actually build soils, and over a period of time, they will start to fill up and become level terraces over a very long period. But by then you've got a very large forest there. You don't need the swale. Or you can side cast the material out onto the mound and increase the mound. You can actually keep redressing it. Doesn't matter. You can even put domestic wastes and organic matter into a swale in buried pits. You can bury pits in a swale.
This is like swale furniture, swale attachments.
These will fill up with water and they will become rich soil deposits inside a swale, either in the mound or in the trench itself.
And on windy sites, the swale spoil bank, this swale bank, it's actually a very sheltered starting place for plants and trees. And every 6 to 10 swale can be planted to a windbreak, where wind is the limiting factor. You can use the swales themselves as windbreak swales, and the swales in between as production swales. So they go into another function. And we know ridges should always have windbreaks, because ridges are out there in the wind. But also there's more condensation on ridges, and that condensation is a trickle down moisture with nutrient. And if it's swelling downhill, we're picking that up and spreading it out. Swale sections can be over deepened as well. So there are places where we can put in deep sections. And this is most effective in clay fraction soils, creating kind of ephemeral ponds. Where if we're in sands, we can often go into widening for more effect. And in volcanic fraction soils, which are like sands as well, very absorbent, there we can create soak pans that readily absorb water and increase the groundwater recharge. Swales can be kept to a convenient width. So they can be a foot track, or they could be a wheelbarrow track in a garden. Or they could be, on a small property, a quad bike track. Or they could be a tractor track on a large property. They can be used for transporting supplies in and produce out. There are many different functions for a swale. You need to get a longer swale to get material in, to mulch, to compost, to fertilize, to water possibly in really dry periods. You might want to flood a swale if you've got dams uphill. And you need to get product out. They're a convenient way to get across country because they're perfectly level. We are continuously surprised at the performance and function achieved by swales.